So we have Brent Beaven here, and he is from New Zealand's Department of Conservation. He's a program manager with New Zealand Government's Predator-Free 2050 campaign. This role focuses on strategic direction, systems and processes needed to make a predator-free 2015 succeed. So prior to this, Brent spent 2 years as an advisor to the Minister of Conservation. His background involves 20 years of operational conservation service, which involves spending 16 years on Stewart Island. So what a great, great background you have there. Just before Brent kicks off with his presentation, just to remind everyone here is to engage in the Q&A. So please let us know what your questions are. We'll be moderating your questions because there'll be a time to have a really good discussion about New Zealand's Predator-Free 2050 campaign. So thank you very much, Brett.
Thank you, Naomi. And gosh, I hope your voice is going to last through 3 days because you're sounding a bit croaky at the moment. Hey, we've got six speakers following this in the Predator-Free session, and they're each going to cover in depth some individual elements across the breadth of the work that we're doing in Predator-Free. And what I want to do in this presentation is bring it all together to show the overarching structure and way we're approaching this. This has been described as New Zealand's moonshot, and I think the very idea of eradicating three classes of animal predator, vertebrate animal predator, off 26 million hectares could well be called challenging and ambitious. But it is a story about collectivization and collaboration. It is a story about working together. And it's one of these lovely goals where there is no lose. Even if we don't get there, by driving ourselves forward around a clear goal like this, we're going to get into a much better place with much more effective tools and the ability to protect our species, our native wildlife, beyond what we've had opportunity to do before. So I'll start off with a lovely video, which will set the scene.
E mihi atu tēnei ki a koe, te taonga tāne mahuta e.
Ko te ngahere, te wāhi, i tīmata ai, i tupu ai, te huiwi. Engari, i rote i toku ao, ko ki te kē au, i te wāo, i te ngahere, e mate ana, i te mahi, a te paihanu. Nā te mea ko tātou ngā kai tieki, o te ngahere, ngā tātou tonu, e tieki, e te ngahere.
We're rapidly innovating. We have a lot of new technology available now that we didn't have 10 years ago. The speed of new things being developed is exponential. We can absolutely make Predator-Free 2050 happen, yeah.
I feel like hunters have a massive part to play in all of this. We all want to see our native birds and our native species all restored back to the way they were. We need to remove these predators from New Zealand to look after what we cherish most.
Over the decades, we've sadly seen a loss of our native birds. If we all work together, we could really bring the birds back in our neighbourhoods.
We're a country that prides ourselves on our natural environment, and we're not afraid of a challenge. If New Zealand commits to a predator-free future, we will do it.
And when we do, future generations will watch the land return to its fullest strength. Birds, insects, and reptiles will inhabit every corner of Aotearoa again.
Te mahi ngā tātou, tēnei mahi rangatira, tēnei mahi tapu, kaora, te ngahere.
Right, which is a lovely video, I love that. But one of the things that it talks about and what you've got on the slide is the reason that we do this work. And I think when you work in the vertebrate pest world, it's really easy to fall into talking about animal pests and how we kill them and better technology. But it is about saving these species that, in New Zealand sense, we've got a huge amount of endemism and these species only occur in New Zealand. So they're our accountability to protect. And unfortunately, as a nation in New Zealand, we're not doing that well. We've got 4,000 species classified in trouble, and 1,000 of those are in serious trouble or facing extinction. And the main drivers of those, one of the main drivers is possums, rats, and stoats, the three introduced vertebrates that have arrived in New Zealand. mainly because our native wildlife, predominantly our bird fauna, evolved in the complete absence of mammalian predators. So their best defence was to freeze or to hide or to nest in holes to keep away from avian predators. So freezing and smell and being smelly and hiding in holes is not a good defence for possums, rats and stoats. So we've seen a commensurate decrease in the number of native species, native wildlife we have. And I mean, I've worked in this space for over 20 years and the last biodiversity strategy that New Zealand had was to halt the decline. And in all honesty, we've failed in that drive. And as we look forward for the next 20 years, we need to do something different. Like, we need to do something substantially different if we want to reverse the decline in our native wildlife. And that's where predator-free 2050 came from. It is a substantially different goal. But that said, I want to just put up front that we recognise it won't be easy. There is a substantive difference between eradication and suppression. And I think in general terms, we can say that suppression is about removing 90% of your animals for 10% of your cost. Eradication is about removing that last 10% for 90% of your cost. So it's a substantially different approach, and it requires the right mindset to deliver on it. So we're very aware how difficult this challenge is, and it does need a national response that's collectively thought out and with the right science underpinning it. So to give that some national structure, we developed a strategy which was released last year and approved by the New Zealand government and New Zealand Cabinet. And it's as an overarching strategy for how we'll structure this and the general approach we'll take. And the action plan maps out the milestones that have to be met to deliver predator-free. So through the mapping of those milestones, I've gained a lot of confidence in the ability of the program to deliver this, as long as we can meet those milestones. But the strategy, at its simplest sense, has a three-phase approach, which we call mobilize, innovate, and accelerate. So mobilize is about getting the system right. It's about preparing communities. It's about connecting organisations together, getting people to work towards a common agenda, creating collaborative mechanisms that will allow organisations to work together in new ways. And it's about building capability and capacity, both within the science system, but also within communities and also in Māori in New Zealand. The innovate phase is just recognising that we don't at the moment have the tools and technology to deliver this at scale across all of the habitats that we have within New Zealand. We're close. There's some really good innovation happening, and there's 60 years of previous conservation experience to draw upon that gives us confidence we can get there. But we do need to put a real focus on new knowledge, new trials, new ways of learning, and that's what the innovate phase is all about. And the accelerate phase is saying, look, when we've got the system ready to go and we have the technology available to deliver on this, then we want to accelerate really quickly across the landscape. So it will be, those hectares treated in the end will be at the end once we've got this nailed. And to give you some concept about that, at the moment we've got a sort of rule of thumb that we expect 30% of our national resource and energy to be going into that mobilise phase, 60% into the innovate phase, and only 10% into the acceleration phase. Now, it doesn't mean we don't do large chunks of work on the ground or invest in regional projects, but we have to wrap them into that innovation mindset. So we have to wrap them into a learning mechanism where we understand that actually every dollar we spend at that site needs to be based around learning to make the boat go faster, to learn something that will enable us to scale this across the country. So, yeah, innovation is not just around the science and technology, it's also around the doing, but making sure we have a learning framework. And the key difference between that and an acceleration framework is that failure is okay in a learning framework, that once you make a mistake, we want to be promoting it because we're interested in what we've learned, not about whether you achieved your key performance indicator or not. So to organise those three phases, mobilise, innovate and accelerate, we've come out with six strategic pathways in the strategy, and they're really a functional grouping of like activities to try to give it some focus. So there's one around Māori expressing their kaitiakitanga, or their ability to work and interact and manage and look after the land. It's one about empowering and inspiring communities to take action. So how do we involve communities? How do we create the right level of education? How are we communicating? There's a big chunk of work around knowledge, innovation and improvement, how to create new technologies, how to do the learning we require in this space. A section of work around legislation and policy requirements to make sure we've got enabling legislation that you're not getting stuff getting in the way. But around measuring, assessing the difference we make, as I will probably come right through the conference, data management, understanding exactly what to monitor, how do we share data, how do we access data through the backcountry. There's a big chunk of work in there at the moment, so it's got its own work stream. And the sixth one is this idea of how do we integrate in our actual pest control on the ground that's happening through various agencies, and then shift that eventually towards eradication. So to organise, to run those six pathways, we've created national collaborative groups, which are an interagency collaborative group. This is not a stakeholder group. This is about taking the people who are spending money and resource in this area and connecting them together so that we leverage off each other to get the maximum impact we can for New Zealand. It also recognises that when you start dealing in complexity, it goes beyond the scope of any one individual organisation to deal with. So the mandate for Predator Free is bigger than the Department of Conservation. It's bigger than Predator Free 2050 Limited, a Crown-owned company that's been set up that Dan Tompkins will talk about. It's bigger than Ministry for Primary Industries. It's actually all of these combined need to work together to deliver the mandate and the actions that are required to achieve Predator Free 2050. So we've set up one collaborative group per strategic pathway based on a collective impact model. It seems that if you want to set up something like this, collective impact seems a good mechanism. And it's what they're working through at the moment is trying to develop action plans to go forward for the next 5 years. And that's working on the idea that although we're on a 30-year mapped out pathway, we want the detail for 5 years and keep that bow wave moving ahead of us, so that as we drive change and new technology and new ways of operating, they can be incorporated by this living collaborative group that can keep things working. If we don't have a structure like that or a system, then we will we'll just have a static strategy which won't achieve the outcomes. So I want to talk about the science collaborative group as an example. This is about bringing together all the people who are either funding or doing research in this space. We've also got regional councils, but I couldn't find a shared logo for them. So this is a really neat space in that we're shifting away from that competitive model. It's still a space for competition, but it doesn't have to be the be-all and end-all of science delivery, and trying to bring it into a more shared collaborative model, saying, actually, this is big enough that we all need to contribute towards this. And I just threw this slide in because this is some of the early thinking coming out of that group. And the bit I like about it is they brought it into three themes. One was around building and sustaining public support, which was the social science elements of this. How do we do the social science that keeps communities engaged and understanding what steps we need to take? And the other two themes I find really interesting, because one is around achieving eradication at scale, and we need to shift scale within New Zealand. We need to shift from 12,000 hectares being our biggest eradication to over 100,000 hectares. So some key science questions around that. And the other theme is, how do we defend? How do we maintain that? If we actually move to the mainland and we're going to achieve eradication, how do we keep the pests out again? And if we can't defend, it's probably not doing it in the first place. And what I liked about this was the science group very quickly came to those three themes and then said, well, if we're not working in these three areas, we're probably working on the wrong stuff. And that just that shift into that more collaborative and more structured and more focused intent has been a really good step. I'd like to deal with a system diagram because I love systems. I don't know if there'll be, so if I love them, I'm sure lots of other people do. And this is just showing that, look, we have a strategic plan across the top, which is organised into six work streams that I've talked about, which has a collaborative interagency group looking after each one. As a part of the system that has a steering group just to make sure that collaborative intent's working well, and they reset the five-year strategy. About every 5 years, they'll reset that strategy. What I'm finding there is a real engine of predator-free at the moment is these collaborative interaction agency groups are doing action planning. Now, that's going to bring together all of the individual actions that are required around predator-free across agencies with clear roles and accountabilities to really show what we're going to be working on over the next 5 years. And that leads to allocation of roles to an agency or an organisation. They do their work in whatever form that is. And once they've done the delivery of that work, you get new knowledge based on the outcomes of it. And the system is set up is that they feed back into that collaborative group, which enables the action planning to change so we can keep this adaptive and live as we go. So if we step away from that science space, the other really interesting space in predator-free is around Māori partnerships and the voice of Māori in this. And there's what became evident when we did a whole lot of national hui as we worked our way around the country trying to understand what it is about predator-free is just how many barriers there were to Indigenous people having that ability to do their traditional practices and to exercise the responsibilities and accountabilities they feel towards our wildlife and our Indigenous forests. So it became as a real, and I have to admit, that was a real learning journey for me. And the thing I started to understand most is how intrinsically linked Māori culture is to the environment. It basically evolved from the environment, and all of the practices are strongly linked to it. So one of the things that particularly impacted on me as I went through this is that these introduced species, these introduced vertebrate pests that we have, are not only eating our native wildlife out from under us, they're also eating our Indigenous culture out from under us. And our Indigenous culture is something that makes New Zealand, New Zealand. And we think about what makes us New Zealanders, that's one of the key elements. And that's been a real eye-opener. And I think as we think forward, we need to find ways of when we create system governance or governance for this program, that it is inclusive and cognizant of this need and that ability of our Indigenous people in New Zealand to be included within that. And I think at this point, one of the things I've realised that predator-free is a journey, and we're aiming for something. Getting there is one thing. How we get there is just as important. So I think we could phrase that as the journey to predator-free is just as important as the destination. And we have a lot of work to do in that place. So if we look at our overall sort of approach, and we can put the social issues aside, which are huge and need a whole lot of work around, because people are complex, and I think we all realise that. So it's much easier to deal with the other bits, but we'll work through that complexity as we engage communities at place and help them feel involved in decision-making around what's going to happen. But at the moment, we need to create some tools, and those tools are around scale and defendability. So if we look at scale, we've got two key programs we're investing in. One is South Westland, which is being led by Zero Invasive Predators. And I know Phil's giving a talk about that work a bit later. And that's almost taking an adaptive management type approach to really scale up quickly across 100,000 hectares based on what they've learned so far and the work they've been doing across New Zealand and the Perth Valley and seeing on South Westland whether they can expand that out and solve issues as they go, hence the adaptive management type approach, and get to scale quickly. The other investment we've got is predator-free Stewart Island or predator-free Rakiura. The investment there is it's 169,000 hectare island, and it's we're trying to really test scale using more an applied design approach. So we will workshop, we'll understand what we don't know, and we'll come out with pilots and that to try to solve those unknowns and come out with a clear operational plan. Now, there are two really valid approaches for operating at scale on the mainland, and it's a really, because we're in that innovation phase, it's a really good time to test different operating models for how we might go forward. Both of those are on a five-year horizon, and we expect in 5 years it may be a little slip, but about then, we'll have a really clear idea of how we will start to deliver eradication at 100,000 hectares or more. Then we want to think about defendability, which is our other element. If we want to defend, there's two bits of work we're doing there. One is, again, led by ZIP and predominantly focused in the southwestern site at the moment, ZIP being Zero Invasive Predators, this little focused company working on these issues. So they're looking at natural barriers such as fast-flowing large rivers, coastal areas, and the alpine fault or mountains, and how they can break the environment up to prevent pests moving across it, especially if you reinforce those boundaries. But the other part that becomes really important with us is what we do around farmland. So we've kicked off some work, and there's a whole lot of existing work we're trying to bring together and coordinate, and Steve Ellis will probably talk about this a bit later, is trying to achieve eradication on farmland because it does make up two-thirds of New Zealand. When we have achieved eradication on farmland, if you leave your infrastructure in place, what we're really interested in is, can you use that infrastructure to act as a barrier to pest movement? If a pest comes on one side of a farm or sequence of farms, will it get killed before it comes out the other side? If we can crack that, then we've suddenly got the tools to go to scale and the tools to defend these areas at scale across the country. And that's quite a positive step at the moment, and what our current sort of strategy and approach is.